A new report on supply chain sustainability from the Council of Supply Chain Management Professionals and the MIT Center for Transportation and Logistics. To talk about it, I'm joined by Chris Adderton. He is Vice President of CSCMP, and Alexis Bateman, who is Director of MIT Sustainable Supply Chains for the MIT Center for Transportation and Logistics. Chris Adderton, let me greet you real quickly. Hello.
Hi, Bob. How are you today?
And Alexis, welcome.
Thanks for having me.
We start out by asking Chris, why now? Why the need for a new report on supply chain sustainability?
Well, Bob, the pressure is growing on industries and companies to define their commitment to sustainability and supply chain. But it's highly variable, dependent on the industry and the company's commitment to this sustainability project. And in fact, it's an ongoing and evolving commitment by most companies. The challenges they're faced are determining which areas have economic vitality and viability over time. And as important, there's a social component to this, as well as a physical component, environmental component to the supply chain sustainability projects that are currently in place.
So Alexis, how did you approach the study, the types of companies you reached out to, the executives, the industries? What was your starting point?
Yeah, well, the first kind of approach to this was to engage supply chain professionals. So, you know, a lot of the studies are approached from the executive level, which obviously have a much different perception of supply chain sustainability than supply chain professionals who are on the ground, who are engaging day to day in some of the operations. And so we actually, as a first approach, surveyed supply chain professionals in around the world. It wasn't actually globally representative because, you know, it's really tough to get a globally representative sample. That's our objective in the second round, but our objective was to hear from them what they were seeing, how they saw their firms were engaging, and we felt that that would be a, you know, more unbiased perspective on how sustainability was diffusing into supply chain. So that in itself was trying to look across industries, across positions, across regions and nations, and that was the core of our approach was from supply chain professionals for a report that would be for supply chain professionals. Mm-hmm. And then we reached out to executives that did have existing programs in supply chain sustainability to talk about how they saw supply chain sustainability, where they were receiving pressure, how they were acting. And we chose those executives, the results they could talk about why their companies were acting. And so in some ways they are biased because they already have a program, but it complemented the findings that we saw with the professionals where they were able to talk about what they're seeing with firms that may or may not be, you know, invested in sustainability. And then a third piece was looking at different corporate social responsibility reports and other reports and media coverage to see what were key trends in the areas of sustainability. And so mm-hmm. by looking at all three, we could kind of gauge what's happening on an annual basis.
Well, let's back up for a moment and talk about terms, because the word sustainable certainly gets bandied about quite a bit these days, and who knows what it really means. What was your working definition of sustainability in order to determine whether indeed these supply chains were sustainable?
Yeah, so, you know, our gauge was something that includes social and environmental factors. So much of what many are talking about in sustainability, they're always talking about green supply chains, right? So primarily on the environmental side, but we took a more holistic definition that looked at social and environmental factors. And so we looked at supply chain sustainability, which was the management of environmental and social impacts within and across companies and networks, and that was consisting of suppliers, manufacturers, distributors, and customers. And so we mm-hmm. looked at very holistically. Of course, that, you know, increases the challenge of making it much broader, but I also thought that that coverage was something that really wasn't out there at this point, to look not only across the supply chain, not just one industry or one sector, but then also look at both social and environmental factors. And mm-hmm. So we defined that, and, you know, the issue areas that we selected were based on numerous reports, the UN SDGs, you know, how companies were defining their areas of approach. And then actually that was one of the most challenging parts, is to kind of define what issue areas are highly relevant in supply chains for social and environmental impact. And so that in itself was sort of this first tackle of seeing what are the issues at hand.
Okay. I want to talk about some key findings. It's going to be difficult to sum them up in just a few minutes here. And I do want to hear Chris's kind of higher level view on CSCMP kind of perspective on what those were. But let me start just for a moment with you, Alexis, and ask for you, to the best of your ability, just sum up for me, like, what are some of the key findings of note, maybe something that surprised you, something that kind of jumped out at you? What did you come up with as a result of this study?
Yeah, so there were several key findings that stick out, you know, one of which is, you know, a lot of the long history of where pressure from sustainability is coming from, everyone's like, it's the NGOs. You know, they're campaigning, they're in their gorilla suits campaigning at headquarters, that's why we do it. And or it's the, you know, that green consumer that's demanding more sustainable products, which, you know, there is those consumers, but again, in some of our research, we haven't found them to be the driving force as a result of, you know, limited willingness to pay. You know, there's certainly a demand, but not necessarily on a, right, on a price premium component, right? And I think there is a demand, but what was interesting was the pressure for those that felt pressure, it was diffuse across sources. So it was coming from consumers, it was coming from NGOs, it was coming from media, it was coming from regulatory agencies, you know, from their own executives, you know, so the pressure was across all these different sources, and they were almost weighted very equally for many industries, right? Certain industries saw heavier pressure, for instance, you know, extractives, we're seeing it more on the regulatory side, you know, more consumer-facing industries, we're seeing it on the consumer side, but the breakdown was pretty equivalent. And so that in itself was very surprising for me, for someone who's been looking at this for quite a while. The other big finding was that the way that, you know, the issue areas were laid out, you know, they were kind of equal across the board, and you know, whether it be environmental issues and such as, you know, carbon emissions reduction or water management. And then there were other issues, avoiding or ensuring no child labor or no forced labor, all these issues. And actually social issues were ranked very heavily as very critical to their company's supply chain sustainability efforts. Mm-hmm. And that may be because, excuse me, you know, people issues and social issues are sort of, you know, non-negotiable, right? Child labor in our perspective is non-negotiable. No one wants child labor in their supply chain, even if it might be lurking deep in the supply chain, they just don't know it's there, right? So mm-hmm. I think that sort of black and white perspective emerged from the findings, was that no one wants those labor violations, even if they don't actually know they're there. And environmental issues came out as sort of, I don't believe this to be true, but nice to have, right? Those are the kind of secondary factors. And so that was an interesting finding. We'll see what turns out in the second years. You know, that will be almost the most exciting to see how it changes year over year. And the last one I'll pull out, there were many, of course, but was, and this it may have been, you know, it was obviously a biased sample by people who self-selected to fill out the survey, right? So, yeah. You know, it was voluntary. We didn't force anyone. We just said, you know, please fill it out. And surely those that are interested in sustainability are probably more inclined to fill it out. But we were really surprised that the high proportion of professionals who said that they were directly involved in sustainability. So I want to say it was close to 40%. Said they were either primary decision makers or directly involved with sustainability. And for me, that was pretty significant that they felt that they were, you know, actively engaged. And then there was, you know, certainly breakdowns between the industries in terms of who had the highest engagement, who had the lowest engagement was interesting to see. And so all those, that portion of professionals that are engaged was surprising and on the higher end than I expected to see.
Yeah. Now, Chris, from your perch at CSCMP, a lot of this information has been available to you over the years anecdotally. You certainly are in constant contact with supply chain executives and probably having conversations all the time about sustainability. But what did you glean from this particular study that either tracked with what you already knew or was different from what you knew? What was your takeaway from the results of this study?
Well, as supply chains gotten more critical and more visible to the world at large, particularly in the current environment, this is about business issues at heart, right? So social responsibility and sustainability is critical to brand equity. To Alexis's point, you don't want to be the outlier, right, that finds out after the fact that something is not right in your system. So not only do the right thing, but do it the right way. Is critical. Same thing with the environmental components. There have been examples where people have pivoted and say, I recognize there's a cost to doing this, but we believe in the long run versus the short run, quarterly report. This is the best thing we can do for the enterprise at large. A classic example is Big Oil has gone through significant changes in the current environment, and BP's declared that they recognize they're going to have to restructure and there's significant financial costs, but we're going to be the green energy company. And also operational components. There are ways for people to embrace sustainability and look to take waste out that then has material benefit to natural resource utilization or lower carbon footprint. A number of our companies have continued to declare that and report on progress on those things. But I think the point of the MIT research and Alexis's team research is it's highly variable depending on the industry and the company and the size of company you have. I believe senior leaders believe it's sort of a cultural responsibility to do the right thing. The question is how you execute it and sustain it within a business model that you have to deliver still quarterly earnings.
Yeah. Only a couple of minutes here left really to us, but I just want to get a quick statement from each of you. Let me start with Alexis. Alexis, how do we keep this report from being just another report that gets shoved onto a shelf somewhere and then we go forward and nothing gets done? How do you see the value of this study going forward in enacting real progress and sustainability?
Well, a few reasons, one of which is that it's very accessible. So, you know, a lot of reports out there are the 300-page, you know, you're not even crack it. I could say that you could probably sit down this and read this very succinctly and get some key learnings and think about, as a professional, what role can you play? What is happening in your industry? And kind of get situated within supply chain sustainability. It's very entry level accessible. And so for that, I think that that is much different than many reports out there that any supply chain professional can pick it up, gauge what's happening, what happened in 2019, and then know that we're actually collecting, which will be released at Edge, the next year's survey. So we'll actually, you're going to kind of be involved in this ongoing story of how it's evolving over time. So it's, you know, sort of like you'll get the next edition as, you know, other state of reports that say like, okay, well, 2019 is what it looked like. We know 2020 is much different than 2019. It's not going to be even close to remotely the same. And so for that, and I think that for any professional that is sort of like on the fence about knowing more about supply chain sustainability, knowing their company is or is not acting, it's just very accessible. It gives them a quick read on supply chain sustainability, and they can kind of situate themselves within that and know that they'll be able to get that very same kind of results in the next year.
And Chris, just real quick, give me a perspective. What can CSCMP, what do you feel that the organization can do? How can it use this study going forward to enact change among its own membership and beyond, for that matter?
Yeah, like many of the things we do, we want to give people insight, perspective, or best practices, right? And this is at the core of creating some ability to get what I call the power of comparative performance, right? So what are other people doing? What are other industries doing? And do I have a reference point as opposed to just an internal metric that says, oh yeah, we're much better year over year? I think that's the role of CSCMP collectively, to continue to show people a path forward that has high probability of improving performance, whether that's a moral commitment to sustainability or a reduction in social injustice, or it's operational effectiveness. That's our role in the market, to connect, educate, and advance the supply chain profession.
Okay, well, good message and a good information for companies to get out there and make their supply chains even more sustainable and raise awareness everywhere about this critical issue. Chris Adderton of CSCMP, Alexis Bateman, MIT. Thanks both of you so much for joining me today to talk about this study. Thanks a lot.
Thank you so much, Bob.
Thank you, Bob. Appreciate the time.